very good evening and welcome. It's the top of 9 o'clock. It's a special broadcast of The Nation at 9 with me, Rishabh Gulati.
And with me, Geeta Mohan. We'll be beginning this broadcast on Donald J. Trump's oath-taking. The inauguration has begun. The ceremony is underway even as we speak, and even as the world is coming together to discuss what Donald J. Trump's policies are really going to be. Most saying he's quite unpredictable. We'll be talking about Donald J. Trump and United States India policies are really going to be. Most saying he's quite unpredictable. We'll be talking about Donald J. Trump and United States India policies.
The entire breakdown begins in about 40 minutes from now. Let's cut live across to Washington as we speak, where all the guests have begun to arrive at the Capitol Hill, where the oath-taking ceremony is going to take place at about 10:17 p.m. We're going to put those live visuals onto your screens. The former president, George W. Bush, has arrived. Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton expected to arrive shortly. Before this, Donald J. Trump was at the Arlington Cemetery. He was also visiting a church as part of all the obsequies that are followed in the build-up to the oath-taking ceremony. Those are live visuals coming in from inside Capitol Hill, and we'll be staying with them right across as the build-up takes place. Joining us on the broadcast this evening to help examine the impact of India as we absorb the most powerful democracy in the world, swearing in one of the most powerful political offices in the world, and view it from the world's largest democracy as to where we sit. On the broadcast with us tonight, Simon Marks. He's our correspondent there in Washington. He's with us live there. Richard Russo joining us as well. Leela Punappa, former Secretary of the MEA and the former Deputy NSA, joining us. Suhasini Haider, the Foreign Strategic Affairs Editor of The Hindu, is with us. Yogendra Yadav is with us. Sishadri Chari joining us, representing a BJP voice. Professor Sumit Ganguly from the Indiana University joining us live via Skype. And Lisa Curtis, a Senior Research Fellow from the Asian Studies Center, also with us as you're watching these live broadcasts coming in. We're going to stick with these live visuals as you see Jeff Bush there on your screens. But a quick introduction of who this man, Donald J. Trump, actually is, from his birth to his ascendancy as the 45th president of the United States. Here's a report. It's an insight. It's quite a telling one behind the maverick that is about to become the president. Listen in.
Years ago, in a wealthy neighborhood in Queensboro, Trump was the fourth of five children of a millionaire real estate developer. Born with a silver spoon, Trump was even taken to school in a limousine. His millionaire father was called a work machine. Naturally, Trump got ambition in his DNA. In early years, it became imperative to discipline Trump, and he was packed off to the military academy. His dreams, however, were a bit different.
What was your fantasy when you were very young?
To be a baseball player. I was a great baseball player.
What position?
First base. Catcher, mm-hmm. First base. But in those days, you got paid $2, right?
And that's not for Donald Trump.
I mean, no. But my other fantasy as I got older was to do movies. I wanted to be a movie maker.
He was always fascinated by stardom and cinematic brilliance. He even married a Czechoslovakian supermodel, Ivana. But his father made him return to his family business.
I started off making little deals in Brooklyn and Queens with my father, and they seemed to work out.
And then he struck out on his own with determination and energy, and his wife, who played a crucial role in his business ventures.
What words would you use to describe Donald Trump?
I've always had great imagination. I've had great success with money. I've actually gotten along well with people over the years.
Being non-conventional, Trump also set out to conquer the world of television.
My name's Donald Trump, and I'm the largest real estate developer in New York.
He also appeared in several commercials and serials.
Excuse me, where's the lobby?
Down the hall and to the left.
Look, I tell you what, you want another 50 grand, I cut the grass for you every Saturday. We eat our pizza the wrong way.
Crust first.
While he erected his signature Trump Towers across the world, his personal life hit choppy waters. After his divorce from his first wife, Ivana, the mother of his three children, Donald married Marla Maples in 1993. That marriage, too, lasted only 6 years. In 2005, he married the glamorous and much younger Melania, a Slovenian model. Soon the two will be moving out of their fancy Trump Tower to the most stately White House.
I am looking around this room. The White House might be a step down.
The White House is the White House. It's just a spectacular place. And, you know, it's something that represents something very special.
An outsider has finally stormed the bastion of the White House.
I love this country. Thank you very much.
And we are opening up our discussion with the special broadcast on Donald J. Trump's inauguration ceremony, starting with Simon Mark. Simon, what's happening on the ground? We know you spoke about the protests. You also spoke about all those people who've been mobilized into coming and participating in this oath-taking ceremony.
Well, look, I mean, this is a moment of great pageantry here in Washington, D.C., absolutely symbolic of the peaceful transition of power that Barack Obama and, of course, other political figures here have argued is the hallmark of American democracy. We have seen within the last few minutes Hillary Clinton arriving on Capitol Hill. She is attending this inauguration. Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump's rival last year, who just a few days ago was described by Donald Trump on Twitter as guilty as hell. He once again reiterated on Twitter his view that she should never have been allowed to run for the presidency. So great were the criminal acts that he alleged she committed by using a private email server. Hillary Clinton, nonetheless, at least for today, is burying the hatchet. She has appeared on Capitol Hill with her husband, former President Bill Clinton. It is, of course, tradition that former presidents attend the inaugurations of their successors. But breaking with tradition, at least 60 Democrats, members of the House of Representatives, are boycotting this inauguration. They launched that boycott after, again on Twitter, Donald Trump sparked a row with an icon of the civil rights era here, Congressman John Lewis, over the last few days. That is symbolic of an unprecedented sense of polarization in this city. You know, we've talked a lot about polarization in American politics over the last several years. This is polarization at an entirely new level.
And we're expecting
crowds of people here in Washington coming in to celebrate Donald Trump's inauguration, crowds of protesters coming in to demonstrate against
And we're expecting, Simon, the speech to be short, only about 20 minutes, and it's going to start in about an hour from now. It's unusual for the speech to be so short, but for the rest of us looking from the outside in, what should we be really looking for in that speech?
Well, yeah, I mean, it is unusual for it to be as short as 20 minutes, although they're often not long, these inaugural addresses, not least because it's the middle of January here in Washington, D.C., so it's invariably bitterly cold up there on Capitol Hill, although today it's relatively mild, a touch of rain, as you will have seen. Look, I think Donald Trump will, like all of his predecessors, seek to sound cadences of unity, the importance of trying to get the country around him, the importance of trying to overcome that polarization. The difficulty, of course, is it's not clear how long those cadences will truly echo around Capitol Hill and through the halls of power here, given how polarized society is, and given that within 24 hours we'll be seeing an entirely different tableau play out on the streets of Washington, D.C. The Million Women March, with hundreds of thousands of people, at least we think, planning to descend on the city to express their view that Donald Trump is not going to be their president. So that task of unifying the country from this vantage point looks almost impossible.
Right. We're also now being joined by Suhasini Haider, deputy diplomatic editor of The Hindu, as also Richard Rosso, who's strategic affairs expert and Vadhwani chair, joining us. Richard, if I could come to you, it looks grand. We're looking at the pageantry there. But when it comes to on the ground, what is it that Donald Trump is really going to do for India? There are concerns that India has with the recent statements on the Trump administration's immigration policies.
Well, I think you kind of break up what you might see from the Trump administration into maybe three different camps. The first is looking at U.S.-India economic ties, defense ties, and energy ties. Energy collaboration, particularly emissions reduction, has been such an overriding objective of the Obama administration. You'd expect that would be decreased, knowing some of the positions that Trump has staked out during the campaign and since being elected. Economic engagement, I think our governments still have yet to find their footing over the many years. Not part of the same trade agreements, unable to move forward on an investment treaty. So really, there's not too much that he's really going to be starting with. He gets to start from scratch. On the defense side, that's where I'm a little bit more concerned, because I think you've seen a lot of progress in recent years driven in large part by having a defense secretary. Then he gets to start from scratch. On the defense side, that's where I'm a little bit more concerned, because I think you've seen a lot of progress in recent years driven in large part by having a defense secretary in the United States, Ash Carter, that saw, you know, a terrific area of collaboration in recent years. So will you have a champion at Carter's level that's going to continue the relationship as we've seen on the defense side?
Okay.
That's unclear.
Okay. Professor Sumit Ganguly, you've been the man behind the scenes over the past two decades of India-U.S. ties. The Trump presidency has a lot of unknowns here.
It is a real unknown because we simply do not know how he's going to approach India. India has not figured prominently during the course of the campaign. The only time issues related to India arose had to do with immigration and also with H-1B visas. Beyond that, he has had little or nothing to say about India. And consequently, we are really in uncharted waters when we are dealing with this new administration.
Okay. If I can just bring in Suhasini Haider. Suhasini, you were there along with Geeta when Trump was elected. For a large part of the country, it was a bit of a shock, not least for the 3 million Indian Americans, the techie community, the Indian students. Some of them have been pertinently concerned with the rhetoric translating into governance. Do you think the presidency will temper that, or will he have to walk the talk?
I think if you hear the experts, certainly the subject of visas is an issue. We've heard just from Ashley Tellis speaking today, writing today. He's the man, Washington Post says, could be even the Trump ambassador to India. And he says that the greatest danger to Indo-US ties doesn't come from any strategic concerns, but comes from the Trump administration's insistence on America first, which will mean not only do Indian, as you said, techies and all the rest have trouble with their visas coming to the U.S., but businesses move back. And so Make in India could lose out to America first in that sense. But I think we do have to take a pause. You know, the idea that Trump has not referred to India should not be of such concern. President Obama, if anything, was known for his anti-India amendments during the nuclear deal. Before that, too, we've seen American presidents come in with not a particularly positive view of India. It is over time that they warm up to India, if you like. And I say that about both Bill Clinton and the senior George Bush, although, of course, George Bush Jr., who came in 2000 and then had to 2001 and then had to deal with 9/11, did warm up to India much more quickly.
Well, Seshadri Chari, if I could bring you in, the National Executive Member of the Bharatiya Janata Party. Seshadri Chari, we've seen how India has been talking about the Make in India campaign. And we see Donald Trump emulate just that, talking about Make in USA, bring the industries back home. How is that really going to play out with Modi and the Modi administration vis-a-vis the Trump administration?
Yeah, see, this is not the first time that the USA is saying something like Make in America. Earlier also there was this issue of Be American, Buy American. This Be American and Buy American was during the Vajpayee regime in India, which was touted as the American version of the Swadeshi movement. And if you remember, Obama also said the same thing as far as his outsourcing to India is concerned. He even mentioned Bangalore by name. So it has been a practice for all the American presidents during the run-up to the presidency. They always say that we are not going to outsource and we are going to give jobs to the Americans and America comes first. and I am an American and I am a proud American and all these things, they go on. But when it comes to reality checking as far as the economy is concerned, USA is terribly worried about the most important element in their security is the cyber security threat. And if the Indians are not there in the US companies, they are going to face real great problems as far as the cyber security issue is concerned. So I don't think this is going to be a very serious matter. And most of these US companies, remember, are all headed by somewhere or the other Indian NRIs.
Yes, that's so true. Yes, that's true. And if you add up, Sajadri Chari, the top U.S. firms, the five of them in terms of their revenue, that's pretty much covering the Indian total annual GDP. Jimmy Carter arriving at the Capitol Hill, George W. Bush before him, Clinton and Hillary Clinton expected in just a bit. Simon Mark still with us. Simon, before we let you go quickly, 20-minute speech. Do we expect Donald Trump to stick to a script this time or he's going to wing it?
I think you can pretty much be guaranteed that this time round he will stick to his script. He will obviously be working off a teleprompter. There is always the possibility with Donald Trump for a little bit of ad-libbing, a little bit of riffing. But, you know, this ceremony has been timed out to the minute, and there is very little opportunity within the course of this ceremony for spontaneity. As soon as it's over, Donald Trump will be heading to lunch with members of Congress. Then the parade takes place down Pennsylvania Avenue as he moves into the White House and the Oval Office. There will, by the way, be a formal departure ceremony for Barack Obama. He will be flying out of Washington, D.C. later today, heading to Palm Springs in California. He's going to take a short break, a few days there, we are told, but he has made it very clear that he intends to come back to Washington. He'll be living here at least until the end of this year, and he has made it clear that, unlike previous presidents, he's going to break with convention and not hesitate to speak out if he feels that Donald Trump is threatening what he described as core American values. So you'll say goodbye to Barack Obama a bit later on, but it's not the last you'll see of him.
Well, Simon, I know you really have to go, but just one quick question from you. The American Press Corps has written an open letter to Donald J. Trump, and it's almost like a dare to shut the press, to try oppressing the press. So quite a daring letter there by the press corps.
Yes, no, look, I mean, there's a huge potential departure, again, from convention and tradition that may be about to take place here in Washington if Donald Trump and the people around him don't embrace the traditional rules and regulations governing the way in which the press corps, particularly at the White House, operates. And there has been no agreement struck yet between the White House Correspondents Association and the incoming Trump team about precisely how all of those relationships are going to work. Donald Trump, on the campaign trail, consistently referred to the press in derogatory terms. He would point to them at the back of his rallies and tell his supporters, those people there, they are absolute scum. There is no love lost between the Trump team and the press. And Donald Trump has his Twitter account. He loves using it. He believes that it is an incredibly powerful tool of communication that allows him to bypass all of those traditional channels.
Well, we have an Indian Prime Minister who loves using his Twitter account also, but perhaps not with the same verbose tenacity that Donald Trump brings to the medium. Simon Marks for joining us from Washington. Thank you. At this point of time, let me quickly invite Leela Ponnappa. Leela Ponnappa, as a diplomat sitting here in New Delhi, how do you prepare for this? Because there are a lot of unknowns of what the Trump presidency is going to bring in. Diplomacy is supposed to be about continuity, it's supposed to be about small steps building over a large period of time. But personality and leadership also holds a good measure. How do we prepare for that presidency, man?
Diplomacy is also about expecting the unexpected. And I think Donald Trump's election was the ultimate black swan, as analysts use the term, of something that was totally unexpected and would have unexpected consequences. I think there are three ways of looking at this. For India, there are some areas of convergence, there are other areas of differences. Terrorism clearly is an area of common concern, so is China. I think there is some convergence in terms of defense cooperation and security cooperation. Immigration is clearly an issue, but I think there could be leveling factors going forward. But I think we need to step back from this and try to get a sense of the bigger picture. And I'm not getting into the issue of Trump's personality, the
nature of the campaign, the nature of his behavior, and so on. He clearly revels in being unpredictable. But if you were to look at policy issues, I think what he represents is a kind of fatigue with the overreach of multilateralism and globalization. Make in America and Buy American, as Mr. Govindacharya has pointed out, have been old policies. Obama himself talked about jobs being Bangalore, but obviously Obama learnt as he spent his years in the presidency.
Well, I'm sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. We'll just come back to you in a second. Live visuals coming in from Washington as the Marines salute. Yeah. That is pretty much the blue and the red. This is Donald J. Trump, the soon-to-be sworn-in president-elect of the United States, walking out of the White House. It's the final farewell from Barack Obama, guides him by his shoulder in the United States, walking out of the White House. It's the final farewell from Barack Obama, guides him by his shoulder into the waiting cavalcade. Barack Obama, of course, heads with him to the Capitol Hill to attend the swearing-in ceremony, after which he'll be returning to the White House and then boarding a chopper and exiting, while the cavalcade of Donald J. Trump, the 45th president of the United States, jumps in. Richard, let me just bring you in on what's happening right now. They're both getting into the same car, the same armored limo.
Well, this is a historic moment, seeing this kind of a transition, two parties that fought so bitterly. I think seeing them and hopefully seeing some goodwill between them in this point will help to lead to, a better transition. But you can imagine everything going on in town. It's a little bit better to be in Delhi these days, seeing the many people that crowded into my hometown of Washington, D.C., both to support the president as well as to oppose. So that's probably the calmest scene that you're seeing in town right now.
Well, the visuals that you're seeing, just a while ago we saw the First Lady with Melania Trump walk out of the White House and towards Capitol Hill. And now we're seeing President-elect Donald J. Trump there. The cavalcade moves with President Barack Obama, the final leg of this journey before he becomes the 45th president of the United States of America. We will be seeing them arrive at the Capitol Hill in some time from now. Yogendra Yadav, founder of the Swaraj Abhiyan Party, also joins us on this broadcast. Yogendra Yadav, we've seen you fight bitterly when it comes to political fights over here in India, and we've seen the kind of bitter fights that we saw during campaigns in the United States of America. But this is what we're talking about when we talk about democracy. The transition seems smooth as of now, but what are the expectations when it comes to having Donald J. Trump as the president of the United States of America?
I don't quite understand which bitter fights are you talking about as far as I'm concerned, because those are not the things that I normally indulge in. But more seriously, allow me to allow a somewhat discordant note here. The simple thing is that we should see this from the point of view of an outsider. There is always a temptation of looking at it as a vicarious participants. The fact is that we are not. We are outsiders. And it's only correct and dignified if we react to it as an outsider. What is happening really is that the largest and the most powerful country is going through one of its lowest moments. They are electing someone who is perhaps the most unpopular, perhaps the most controversial person as the head of their state. But if you look at all this from a distance, the simple fact is this: America is not run by the presidents. It runs despite the president. Presidents actually don't matter. American president is not half as popular as the Indian prime minister. They are very visible. They, of course, give bites and so on. But the system doesn't get affected that much by the president. There are just too many checks and balances in that system. And as far as India is concerned, as the commentators before me have pointed out, if you put everything together, my sense is that we are not actually looking at anything dramatic there. On the ecological front, clearly you don't expect Mr. Trump to be ecological fanatic, to put it mildly. So clearly India has much more leeway there. On economic relationship, there would be some bit of tightening and a lot of posturing that might happen. But because his focus would be more on China, there would be some strategic leeway that Indian government would have.
Okay.
So put all the pluses and minuses together, you're not looking at anything dramatic. So to put it bluntly, I really don't understand what is this fuss about.
What's the leverage? Sumit Ganguly, when it comes to diplomacy, you have to have leverage. Does India still have the leverage of its large market size, of the fact that the Trump administration will need India ever more than before if it indeed has some hope of countering China economically? Is that our leverage? Do we have it?
Much depends on the policies that India pursues. If India is interested in attracting investment, then certainly there is considerable possibility of leverage. But if the Indian market remains limited, if access to the Indian market remains limited, then I'm afraid the leverage will be quickly squandered. Trump is a businessman. He will be seeking opportunities for American firms in India, and to the extent that the Indian market appears hospitable, India will have some leverage. But his primary focus at the moment will be upon the People's Republic of China, because he made it such an important campaign issue,
okay,
and has been talking about China in the last few days. And furthermore, if you look at his appointments, a number of the people that he has appointed to high places are inveterate China hawks.
Right.
So it is hard to see how he's not going to abandon his obsession with the PRC.
Right. So, Hasni Haider, not just about Donald Trump, but also about the team. Controversial ones at that. How do you see the entire team and the foreign policy play out vis-a-vis Russia, vis-a-vis China, and also vis-a-vis India?
On Russia, it remains to be seen. There are so many questions associated with Russia's possible involvement in the American election, particularly on behalf of Trump. And there are a number of investigations currently underway, including okay. one led by the U.S. Senate. So we have to see how these things play out. But currently, Trump seems to be absolutely obsessed with Putin and seems to practically genuflect.
Okay, Professor Ganguly, just stay with us. We're just watching visuals of Jimmy Carter there, the former U.S. president, along with the other U.S. presidents. I'm pretty sure that's the Bush family that he's with. Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton also expected to arrive there. I can tell you President Obama and President-elect Trump are on their way in the cavalcade. In about 15 minutes' time, we're expecting the official ceremony to get underway. We've got that 15 minutes. Let's make the use of it and go through a couple of core issues for all of us. And so, Hasni Haider, pick on them. When it comes to India, on issues like China, on issues like Pakistan, on terrorism, what can we expect?
Well, certainly we don't know what we can expect right now. And I think that's what everyone is saying again and again, that in Trump you have somebody who has said very little about India, but on the other hand, you know, what he said about geopolitics, he can't possibly follow everything because it would just contradict himself. Mm-hmm. For example, as Sumit Ganguly is saying over there, you know, he's got this obsession with China. He's going to get tough with China. And certainly on the economic front, he's made it clear, you know, whether it's currency manipulation, whether it's completely throwing away the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, he is going to go after China on those counts. However, at the same time, he has spoken about pulling out strategically.
Okay, so Asri, I've got to interrupt you. Well, this is going to be an iconic visual. There are a couple of smiles to be had from a former resident or two former residents of the White House, Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton, walking in to the swearing-in ceremony. She's putting on a brave face, Deepa.
Well, that's right, Rishabh. There were a lot of speculations earlier whether they will be attending the inauguration ceremony or not. But finally, we see the Clintons have come out, putting up a very brave front. It was a very bitter fight, a very bitter contest between Donald J. Trump and Hillary Clinton, with Donald J. Trump winning the Electoral College, but in terms of popularity.
And the bitter fight isn't over yet. We're expecting, as we were discussing a bit earlier, a march to take place in Washington. They're calling it the Million Women March, in which a lot of people are expected to gather, saying that he's not my president. In a democracy, that's what happens and what should happen. And the best and the worst sometimes come out on big days. But let me just stick on the theme while we're expecting the two presidents, when one president and the other president-elect to arrive. Quickly, Leela Ponnappa, the fundamentals on Pakistan, on terrorism, on fighting the ISIS, what should we look for, or should we look for anything at this point of time?
Well, I think Trump has made an issue of terrorism and the threat to America. This is part of his hunkering down, putting America's interests first, which is not unusual. It's really just the manner in which he has behaved, because I think for any political leader anywhere, it is the national interest that drives everything else. So I think if India plays its cards well and conveys and the kind of action that would be required.
All right, Ambassador Poonappa, I beg the interruption again, ma'am. The hail to the chief has been sounding. And well, here it is. The former President George W. Bush is entering, and we're expecting President Trump to follow in immediately after this. Just quick update for our viewers. Ambassador Poonappa, carry on, ma'am. Finish your point.
Sorry, I think you broke my thrust on this.
We were discussing Pakistan, China, and Tehran.
The point is that we will obviously have to. Yes, yes, yes. So India has to convey the specific steps that are required to dismantle the terrorist infrastructure. Because frankly on this, while Obama and I think Hillary Clinton, the Secretary of State, understood the problem, there were enough pulls and pressures within Washington to induce a sense of diffidence in the United States to crack down on Pakistan in the manner that was required to be done. And I think this is a message that needs to get through in no uncertain terms.
Rick,
because this is not just a matter of India's interest, it's a matter of global concern.
Rick, would you agree with Ambassador Poonappa?
Well, I think we saw, I think, a transition in the latter part of the Obama administration in their approach to Pakistan. It may not have been quite as visible from Delhi, but those of us that spend a lot of time, you know, directly with White House staff, you know, you got a bit of a reset button here, and especially with the defense secretary that spent time in the Central Command. So his relationships would be, you know, presumably quite strong in Afghanistan, Pakistan, a little bit less so, you know, looking at other areas there. So, I think looking what we saw in the transition there, you may not see a direct continuation, I think, of the drawdown in support for Pakistan to the way that I think we saw a bit recently. But a lot of that depends upon what we can get going with India, because I think India's voice in Washington, D.C. became quite strong when we saw new areas of cooperation. And so India's voice in trying to counsel the United States to draw down support for Pakistan, you know, I think was loudest that we'd ever heard.
All right. First Lady Michelle Obama, well, at least for the next 40 minutes or so, very popular First Lady. She's going to be replaced in the White House with, of course, the Trump family. Let me quickly rope in, if I can, Seshadri Chari, who's been listening into this conversation. Seshadri Chari, many unknowns, but there was a certain turn of the tide. The first 4 years of the Obama administration was considered as dull waters when it came to India. But over the past few months, if nothing else, on crucial things, the NSG, on the missile technology regime, big leaps were made. Does all of that go on the pause for now as we sort of re-engage with a new paradigm?
No, we will have to start re-engaging with the Trump administration as far as all these subjects are concerned. No doubt about it. But as far as India-US relations vis-a-vis India-Pakistan, India-China is concerned, we should remember that even during the Obama regime, India played an important role as far as the Obama regime was concerned. India is going to be playing an important role as far as Trump regime is going to concern. But
right.
Trump's dealing with India and Trump's...
Mr. Chari, sorry to interrupt you, sir. This is the moment of stepping out into the sunlight, or whatever sunlight that a cold winter morning in Washington has to offer. Donald J. Trump in a bright red tie, a more somber looking Barack Obama right behind him. They're putting on the smiles. And, of course, Mike Pence will be sworn in right before the President.
Paul Ryan right behind Donald J. Trump. That's President Barack Obama with President-elect Donald J. Trump walking through Capitol Hill into that open space where the oath-taking ceremony will take place. In moments from now, we'll be seeing
the change of guard in the United States of America.
The senior Republican leadership, as well as the Democratic leadership, Nancy Pelosi, all of them entering the constitutional post holders of near and afar, the current Vice President Joe Biden there with his wife. Ricky, if you can take us through, how does this all work?
Well, you know, we've got, I think, the entire cabinet crowding in there right now. So many terrific icons, I think, from both parties gathered around to watch this take place. And again, you know, for those of us that want to see the country succeed and do well, you know, hopefully this is a moment that we can all come together. But watching the Vice President take the oath, watching the President take the oath, and then the parades that will take place just after the fact, cheering crowds along the sidelines, protesters as well. And then moving in that evening into the multiple balls that take place, three of which, of course, are officially recognized, where the president will attend, and then many others both supporting and against.
That's the Trump family right there, very quiet, very somber looking, not exactly the bright smiles just yet. They're taking it easy to walk very, very carefully. They know very much that the cameras of and eyes of the world are upon them. I wonder if we can just listen in to what's happening there in Washington for a few minutes before we carry on our conversation in the build-up to the oath-taking.
We can expect now is Senator Roy Blunt, who is the inaugural committee chairman, who will be delivering the opening remarks in moments from now. Timothy Michael, Cardinal Dolan, and Reverend Dr. Samuel Rodriguez, and Pastor Paula White Cain will deliver the invocations. Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer will deliver remarks, after which we will see the oath-taking ceremony being conducted first of the Vice President and then of President-elect Donald J. Trump. He will be administered oath by Chief Justice John Roberts. And President Donald Trump will then deliver his inaugural address. That's the family walking in through Capitol Hill into that open space where the inauguration ceremony is taking place.
Yes, and of course, it's a moment of history. One way or the other, depending on which side of the fence you've been sitting on in the United States or which side of the fence you view, and everyone across the world, at least many people who are watching this broadcast here in India and South Asia, will have an opinion and a strong opinion on Donald J. Trump, on what all he said, what he stands for, what he might stand for. But this is, of course, the presidency of the United States, which is an office in its own effect rather than just one individual with a personality. If we can, once again, try and listen in. What's happening on the
ground? Eric Trump, Tiffany Trump, and Barron Trump, escorted by the Senate Majority Secretary Laura Dove and the House of Representatives Chief Administrative Officer Philip G. Kiko.
Playing, the Marines band playing at the Capitol Hill. We are waiting for the two presidents to walk in. It's going minute by minute to clockwork. As of now, I'm going to quickly take comments from across the table. So, Asli Haider, when it comes to an individual like Trump, is it going to have to be personality bonding that is going to be the key to ties, or will strategic interests take play precedence?
We'll know very quickly, to be honest. In the next few months, there are some things, some unfinished ties between the Obama administration and the Modi government. For example, the defense agreements that are still set to be signed. We're looking at the nuclear power agreements with Westinghouse and whether those go through by the June 17th deadline. Also expected is some American help with India's case at the NSG. The Nuclear Suppliers Group will meet again in June. So in the next few months, we should know really how seriously the Trump administration takes India's concerns. And as the participants have said, you know, all the concerns about China, Russia, visas are going to play out. And it really, really does remain to be seen whether Trump does on China economically. Does he follow that up strategically as well? Because if he pulls out strategically from Asia, as he has been speaking about, then that certainly leaves China a lot more room inside Asia. And India's you know, recently set up partnerships when it comes to the South China Sea, the joint patrolling, joint surveillance with the U.S. that has been envisaged. All of that will hang in the balance.
Well, Ambassador Poonapa, the aggressive stand of the Trump administration vis-a-vis China, how is that going to really play out for India? Like Suhasini was mentioning, the NSG and the help from the United States of America, China could really be the stumbling block here.
Well, I think for a long time, and this really goes back to before Trump, before Obama, it's a question of the United States having to decide whether it is going to be an active player in Asia or not. Obama did the pivot, and we heard from then Secretary of Defense Panetta about 60% of U.S. assets being in the Asia-Pacific region. Now, on the one hand, Trump makes the call to Taiwan. He questions the One China policy, which indicates that he is thinking about China's role in Asia and in the overall global order. On the other hand, you have this issue of so-called protectionism. I think reality is going to set in some, at some stage. You know, the campaign is a great place for rhetoric, but it is not one for reality.
Okay.
We know in coming months in terms of what areas Trump will act on and where he won't. And I think China is going to be a factor both in strategic and geopolitical terms, and they're most certainly in economic terms.
Okay, and the world will hold its breath. The moment is upon us, Ambassador Poonapa, and as good television people, we let the pageantry absorb us for a little bit. We're expecting the two presidents, President Obama and President-elect Donald J. Trump, to walk up onto the steps of the Capitol for the swearing-in. Everybody but them has now arrived in order of precedence. The entire cabinet will be following right there. They've gotten enough of a crowd. Enough people have poured into Washington. There's been a bit of rain. The raincoats are out. But there is enough of a crowd. So when it will be a sight to herald for Donald Trump, the protesters are a bit further away and a bit later in the day. You can expect them to be out in numbers also. But enough have come out. There is a lot of controversy. For many viewers who've been following the elections and the post-election aftermath in the U.S. about not being able to find bands and performers for the inaugural ceremony. But luckily, all of that has been put aside. The ceremony as it stands is going to pull itself through. We are expecting any moment for them to walk out as you're watching visuals of the Trump family. The most of the first families are there, three former U.S. presidents. With their wives also at the swearing-in ceremony. It will be the vice president who will be swearing in first, Mike Pence, after which Donald J. Trump will be sworn in by the Supreme Court Chief Justice, after which we are expecting him to make a 20-minute speech. I'm going to leave you to a bit of the pageantry. We're going to continue this conversation, of course, and every pause that we get. Let's quickly listen into what's happening in Washington.
visuals outside Capitol Hill. The president-elect and President Barack Obama both would be arriving in moments from now. The crowd that you see outside clearly shows that the entire security paraphernalia is out there to ensure no untoward incident really takes place. We're looking at top officials, First Lady Michelle Obama right there coming in to the ceremonial space, and we will be seeing Donald J. Trump and President Barack Obama as well walking into the inaugural ceremony space. In moments from now, the oath-taking ceremony will begin this after the national anthem, which is going to be sung by Jackie Ivanko, and the benediction will be delivered by Bishop Wayne Jackson.
Yeah, well, that's right. First Lady Michelle Obama walking in with the wife of Joe Biden, the current vice president. Well, at least he is for the next few minutes. He's going to be replaced by Mike Pence. The visuals that you're seeing on your screens are from inside the Capitol building, where they're coming down the staircase to enter the portico, where traditionally the swearing-in ceremony does take place. There's a bit of rain in Washington, but not enough to interrupt anything. And regardless, nothing could potentially interrupt this ceremony. The umbrellas will be out if need be. There are a bit of smiles there. It is a long walk, and the cameras are being allowed to follow every step of the way. As you're watching this from right outside underneath the American flags on the steps of the Capitol building on the portico there, you see the Marine band that has gathered to play the fanfare as they are, of course, building up to the oath taking, and then you can pretty much expect to hear the Star Spangled Banner. Geeta.
Right. The entire top administration or the nominees of Trump administration, all of them have gathered for this historic moment of the most bitterly fought contest, and with Donald J. Trump now as the 45th president of the United States of America, a lot of questions being raised as to how he's going to conduct his domestic as also foreign policies.
He's feeling the burn right now.
Ben Carson right there, one of the leading nominees in the Democratic race, certainly is... It was a toughly contested fight
lady,
over there for the
Michelle
Democrats.
Obama and the wife of the Vice President, Dr. Jill Biden, escorted by the Democratic Staff Director of the United States Senate Committee on Rules and Administration, Kelly Fado, Ms. Irish Weinshall, and Mr. Paul Pelosi.
Twice before, and of course to stand by her husband, who had a great victory back in 2008, a much harder fought one in 2012. Big smiles. Hillary Clinton, well, she spent a lot of time in public service and as a diplomat, knows how to put on that smile. But obviously, I'm sure there's much gut-wrenching in the second aisle over there happening, one can well imagine. This is the order of precedence taking place over here. The first ladies are out. The entire cabinet is, of course, right behind the president. We saw them entering the Capitol just a short while ago. We are expecting the two of them to enter. Then there's going to be a short speech before the swearing-in ceremony begins at about 10:15 India time, which is roughly in about 20-25 minutes time, 30 minutes time, our time. You're expecting Donald J. Trump to this time, hopefully, stick to the script and speak out what has been written to speak out, although we know he likes to speak freely from his mind, and though the people that voted for him like it that way. Rick Russo is still with us in our studios. Rick, in that speech, what should America be hoping for before we examine what the world should be hoping for?
Well, I hope that we don't hear, I think, any other redirections. To keep the line, he's articulated, some certain things on both domestic policy and foreign policy. Repeal of Obamacare, I think that you'd expect to see also on trade issues, to withdraw from some of the pending trade agreements. I wouldn't be surprised if you hear some vague references to that, although this is not the kind of place where you'd expect him to take those issues and articulate in any kind of great depth there. But probably, you know, throw some hints out there to make sure that the people that brought him to office feel comfortable and okay. But, you know, hopefully use this opportunity, as he did during his the speech just after he won the election, on trying to bring people together and really reach across the aisle.
Professor Sumit Ganguly, you're not the biggest fan of Donald J. Trump for what he stood for in the election. What can he say to change your mind, sir, and perhaps the mind of the majority of Americans who didn't vote for him?
I doubt that he can say anything that would get me to change my mind. I suspect that this speech will be fairly anodyne. He will probably make some nods towards those who did not vote for him. He'll make some references towards bringing the country together. But frankly, I lay little or no emphasis, because I take his statements seriously, particularly the ones he has made in the wake of being elected. He has depicted no willingness to try, little or no compromises, because I take his statements seriously, particularly the ones he has made in the wake of being elected. He has depicted no willingness to try and reach out to those who do not share his views, and consequently, I do not have much stock in this speech. I suspect it's going to be a fairly bland speech. I doubt that there will be very many combative elements to it, but quite frankly, it doesn't mean very much.
Right.
What will make any difference are the policies that he pursues in office, and quite frankly, I'm not sanguine about any one of them.
Right, in moments from now, this lady in blue, Melania Trump, is going to be the next First Lady of the United States of America. So, Hasni Haider, he is going to stick to the script, is what most of them are saying. But it's a divided country that we're looking at, with quite a few artists, stars from the United States of America, who absolutely declined performing in this entire inauguration ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Melania Trump and Mrs. Karen Pence, escorted by the Secretary of
State. That's right. In fact, several well-known artists who were asked to come said no. We also have the dancers, the Rockets, who went, who are going to perform. Many of them saying they didn't want to attend, and they were then given the choice of whether they wanted to or not. But, you know, Geeta, this all gets put behind. Today is a day with the inauguration when the new president takes over. The fact that Hillary Clinton is there, the fact that with the exception of those 60 Democrats, most of the political establishment of Washington is there. And in a short while from now, President Trump will be elected. I think there's only so much you can make of the opposition to President Trump. Whatever the opposition wanted to do, they certainly did before the election. And he has won anyway. And I think we've seen this around the world. When very strong leaders or leaders who are very radical or populist come to power, they evoke very strong reactions of opposition as well. We've seen it in India 2.5 years ago. But then they do get on with the business of running
the business of politics carries on.
And I expect that that's really what is going to happen.
Yeah, the world moves on. The business of politics carries on. It's been
but
a long...
I don't know about business. You know, what Mr. Trump's making clear is that there will not be business.
Oh, well, hopefully
usual.
Not. Hopefully not. It will be kept in trust, we are told. Okay, so Asli, just hang on. You can see, of course... President Obama and Vice President Joe Biden, Nancy Pelosi in front of them. It's been a long road, Geeta, for Melania Trump from Slovenia to the White House.
Well, absolutely. A long, long journey for Melania Trump, but also for Donald Trump from being a builder, from being a businessman, to becoming this huge TV personality, and then having those aspirations. He always had those political dreams and aspirations. And while many asked him whether he's going to enter politics, he always kept people on the tenterhooks. And finally, he revealed himself ahead of this presidential race that he is going to run for president, Rick. And it seems like today is the day to look back on the journey that Donald Trump took in reaching where he's reached today.
A very surprising thing. I can tell you, sitting in Washington, and I know this has been discussed many ways, Washington, both Republicans and Democrats, so very surprised. But, you know, I grew up in rural Michigan, and I think the connectivity that I've got with folks back there, that the auto trade going away, farming community out there, not understanding the benefits of trade. So I also kept my feet in the other side. We're understanding a little bit about what led to the rise of Trump,
ladies
but a spectacular rise, an unexpected rise, and one that certainly caught Washington by surprise.
Vice President
All right, there's Barack Obama.
Escorted by Senate Democratic Secretary Gary Myrick, Senate Democratic Leader and Rules Committee Ranking Member Charles E. Schumer, and House Democratic Leader Nancy Pelosi.
Greeting the To Be First family after having greeted his own colleagues on the left-hand side.
Well, it's a bit about positioning right now. George W. Bush has a word or two of advice on where Obama should be standing. They're exchanging a couple of jokes there. Three presidents are there. In fact, there will be four now gathered once President Obama demits office, as he is scheduled to do in a few minutes from now. The order of precedence is complete. There's only one person left, and that is the president-elect, who's now going to be sworn in any moment now. We're expecting the vice president, Michael Pence, who's already arrived, to be sworn in first. And then, of course, President Trump is next in a line for there. Lots of smiles there. Happy to see smiles. Political differences being put aside for a very short period of time. But much, much more remains to be said and remains to be done. I still have Ambassador Ponnappa with me. Ambassador Ponnappa, again, looking from a prism, as we must, of where the world moves with this, is this going to be suspended animation, ma'am, or do we expect some fast-paced movement, given that Trump is committed, he says, to getting things on the go?
Well, the point is, what is he going to get on the go? So yes, I think hugely suspended animation. But I would like to make a point. His punchline has always been making America great again. And I think it's worth stepping back a bit to try to figure out what did make America great in the first place, which I would really list as great domestic resources and resilience, immigration over the past few centuries, and a huge degree of international engagement.
Okay.
Now, many presidents, including Bill Clinton, came in with this notion that they would focus on domestic issues and so on and so forth. And they found that really the essence of America's greatness lay in its ability to provide the kind of ideas, innovation.
Yeah, well, it is the economy, stupid, as we were once told 20 years ago. We'll give Donald J. Trump his moment of the spotlight here in India also for a few minutes. That's it. That's him entering the portico of the Capitol. Back to Washington.